Hello and welcome everyone to Nirmal Bank. I am Meeral Daria. We have with us Sunil Mehta, CEO at Indian Banks Association, joining in. Sunil, a very good afternoon. My first question coming to you is, what's the kind of impact that you're seeing with regards to COVID-19 on the economy as a whole?
Impact of economy is seriously felt by almost every segment. Because of the lockdown, there was a movement was restricted, and it has greatly affected the people who are with their very meager resources or which are on the hand-to-mouth basis, like earning on a daily basis, spending on a daily basis. So that segment has got impacted much more than those segments which were having adequate resources to take care of themselves and those who can observe the social distancing, those who can observe the comforts of their home and can take care of all the requirements delivered at their home. So they are the people who are still a privileged one, but there are people, a large number of sections which got impacted. And it is this segment which contributes a lot into the economy. Because this is this segment. It's this segment which goes for a labor and goes for construction activity. It is this segment which runs the factories. It is this segment which provides a lot of human resources for our various segments of the society.
Mm. Correct.
Unless and until as a holistic view, the entire industry, the entire ecosystem takes care of this segment, I think it will take time to build the confidence for the complete economic revival. And I think government is taking care. They have come out with some PM Garib Kalyan Yojana. Money has been transferred to the people. But it's not only the government which can do it. Every employer, may it be in the private sector, in the public sector, and will have to take care of this segment which is associated with them. And unless and until that is done, I think it will take time to restore the confidence of the production.
Right. I think the society, the community themselves need to come together to fight with COVID-19. Now, shifting focus to the banking sector, to the financial space as a whole, yes, a lot of relief measures so far that have already been announced by the government. We had the RBI as well that has come in and pitched in. But do you think there is anything that has been missed by the RBI, in terms of relief measures, which could be important and the RBI could look at from here on?
If you want to have my assessment, I can say RBI is really acting very proactively, and they are adopting a very calibrated approach.
Okay.
One thing you will appreciate, that the governor RBI came forward and said, when we approached the governor about announcing certain measures for the banking sector, for taking care of the economy, so on 23rd of March we approached them, by 27th they came out with a lot of relaxation. So almost a lot of things were taken care of, which were our apprehension for the initial stages of lockdown, because initially it was anticipated this may last only for 21 days and things may get normal. But how these situations are evolving, and the RBI has come for the second set of relaxations for the various segments, they have provided adequate liquidity to the system in the form of LTROs. They have even come out with the LTROs for the NBFC sector. So I think in a calibrated approach, RBI is trying to address all these issues and coming forward. We have submitted our wish list to RBI for the funders for need to be done. And I think they are also waiting and watching the evolving situation. And the moment that situation comes, because right now the moratorium is available for 1st of June for everyone. So that moratorium will give them breather during this period. Mm-hmm. So far as delinquencies are concerned, so that will be a respite for all the borrowers. Their credit histories will not get impaired. And maybe government is also working on all the various relief measures. Even today at 4 p.m., just after our this, maybe Prime Minister will come and roll out certain new packages for the entire segments. We have put in a request for MSME sector to come up with a guarantee scheme. We are hopeful that all these things may be factored into while coming out as a relief measures from the government. So what I mean to say is government and RBI are working together, unfolding their different packages to take care of the economy. Just government and RBI cannot take care of all the woes. It is all the organized sector also which have to plan their strategies and gradually change their business models to amend themselves to meet out the new normal. The new normal is, if you expect the same way to people to come to your shops and just buy, that may not happen. So you have to create a system in which the delivery activities can take place, and India is not short of human resources. You can find people, you can provide them with the equipment, you can provide with everything, hygienic equipment and all that. And then that can be enjoyed. And there are people who can afford it and they can pay for it. So that can kick start. So a lot of business models can change. And that business model changes will also require some investment and activities. So all these changes will be the need of the survey. We have to adjust with the new normal. I don't think because historically for all these type of viral diseases, solution do not come in a very short run. It takes 6 months minimum to 1 year. 1 year for the simple because they have to go for a clinical trial, establish it. So we have to learn to live with it. And how to live with it? Realign your business models. Realign your lifestyle. Creating safety measures at your workplaces, safety measures in your transit systems. So everywhere there is a need for realignment. And this need definitely can be leveraged by all.
Right. So realignment should be something that corporate should look at as well. Now, you already mentioned something for the NBFC sector in terms of the LTROs. What is the current stance with regards to granting moratorium to NBFCs?
I think the RBI circular in inception also was not restrictive about giving any moratorium relief to the NBFCs. Even IBA also, when we gave our FAQs, we made it clear that NBFCs usually they borrow a term loan, and in the process, they extend the loan to the different beneficiaries. When the NBFCs are expected to extend the moratorium to the ultimate beneficiary, they are bound to get the moratorium from the lenders also, for the simple reason because ultimately their cash flows are aligned, and the cash flows are basically the recoveries.
Right.
Unless and until they get a cash flow, they cannot meet out their commitment with their lenders. So they had a justifiable demand for getting a moratorium for that term loan facilities. RBI has also clarified their stand that they have left it to the banks that they can provide this moratorium on case-to-case basis. But I can say why they have sent it to case-to-case basis, because in some of the cases, NBFCs, which are especially the high-rated NBFCs, they have got a very good cheaper funding in the form of LTRO facilities. So when they can get a very easy liquidity, which can take care of their existing repayment requirement also and growth requirement also, they may not require even moratorium to pay their dues wherever. But simultaneously, they can provide moratorium to the ultimate lender. So this is a case-to-case basis. Like those cases which are flush with the funds because of the easy availability of the LTRO funding, they may or may not opt for moratorium. But those who don't have other liquidity sources may opt for moratorium. And now the regulator's stand and the banker's stand is clarified that they are ready to offer it on a case-to-case basis.
Okay, so it's going to be more case-to-case basis. Another question that I have is with regards to the availability of liquidity. Now, the liquidity that the RBI has given to the financial institutions is quite, I mean, it's opened up right now. But the major issue that everyone is talking about is with regards to transmission, because the banks are now sitting on liquidity, and by reducing the reverse repo also by almost around 20 basis points, the RBI has sent out a clear signal to them saying that deploy the money. Are you seeing that transmission happening, or do you think there is still that fear amongst the banks to lend in this hour?
I'll address this issue in a different way. It's not a matter of fear. It is, as you can very well understand, it is a problem of ecosystem. Bankers are into the business of lending. If they do not lend, how will they service the interest on deposits of their depositors? So lending is an integral part of their business. They can't shy away from it. If they shy away, they can't run a bank. So it's not a fear. But then bankers are custodian of public money also. They are supposed to pay back that money to ultimate depositors with the interest, and they have to honor their commitment. Even if they get a default on loan, but they cannot default on their payments to the depositors. So they are custodian of public money, and they have got a well-established systems of assessing the credit requirement, assessing the credit needs, and that system and protocols are already there. Now, in the given situation, it is not the normal lending requirement. Usually, what the bankers do, the bankers lend to economy, to the individual enterprise, whenever there is a growth in business, suppose there is an increase in sales, there is an increase in production capacity, there is an increase in say, realization periods and all that, the bankers lend for it, and that becomes a part of the credit assessment process. Right now, the type of lending what is expected is banks are supposed to fund the losses to sustenance. Fund the losses for the sustenance, because these 3 months, many of the companies, many of the corporate, they are not operated at all. But their fixed costs are there. Many of them are paying rent, taxes, electricities, and all the staff costs, because even PM's announcement said that you don't have to retrench people. So the overhead costs are continuing. So that is a loss. That is not an incremental increase in their sales. There is not an incremental increase in their production capacity.
Correct.
So this type of lending, when you do, this type of lending is comparatively more riskier lending than the normal lending.
Absolutely.
Bankers will definitely will look forward for some comfort for making these type of lending. So one of the proposals we have given to the Honorable Finance Minister, and maybe we expect that something positive, especially for the smaller and the mid segment, MSME segment, which is largest employer of the in our country. If they are given this type of fully guaranteed schemes where the bankers can lend and they do not fear that it is a risky because it is guaranteed by the government, then definitely they will be encouraged to lend, and the scaling up can happen very faster. So, because this segment will satisfy a large chunk of the people. When you talk about the larger entities and the corporates, there the RBI has already provided flexibility to them. So the bankers can go and reassess their working capital requirements. Suppose their debt realization period earlier was 60 days. Now it has gone up to 120 days or 180 days. So accordingly, that a debt realization period can be factored into for reassessing their working capital requirement. Previously, such type of changes will tantamount to restructuring. They will be considered for downgradation. But at this point of time, RBI is clear, right? If you reassess their working capital requirement based on these parameters, then this is not treated to be a downgradation. This is not to be treated as a restructuring. This is a normal banking lending. So these enablers are not there. The moment the support comes for the smaller and mid segment, I think the growth engine will definitely start for
it. But you know, I will want to interrupt over here. You know, even if the RBI does not really come out with any relaxation or any guarantee for the MSMEs, who, as you mentioned as well, they are the largest employers right now. If the relief is not given to them in the form of working capital, don't you think these MSMEs who've already borrowed from the banks could in the next 8 to 9 months turn into NPAs? And that's something which will be more troublesome for the banking sector.
You're perfectly right. And I think the banking system has already seen that issue. And they have already come out with a resolution for that. Two of these resolutions which have already been worked on, I think if you see the website of 80% of the banks to 90% of the banks, every bank has come out with a special contingency loan for COVID. That is 10% of their working capital requirement. So 10% of their existing working capital facilities, fund-based working capital facilities, because fund-based I'm talking because they have to pay interest only on the fund-based facilities. And rest of the facilities are non-fund-based facilities. So fund-based facility, 10% incremental lending is available under this COVID line of credit. What is their interest outgo? Even if they are, I take an example which may be on a high side. If they are paying 12% interest, it means for 3 months the interest outgo will be 3%. Wherever the incremental lending available out of COVID, 10% is 10%. So out of this 10%, even 3% can go for servicing of the interest even for this period. So they will not default. So that if they avail like this COVID facility, the special facility designed by the banks, there are no question of their default, because they are getting the incremental funding to service their interest. And in working capital, bankers are only servicing of interest. Otherwise, the facilities are rolled over.
Right.
So, in a way, it has got a cushion more than 3 months because 10% is available. But for 3%, a 1% per month requirement, this can take care of at least 6 to 8 months easily.
Right.
That is one aspect of it. Now, if the government comes out with a... now, why we are asking for this guarantees and all that? So, what we are giving, the COVID 10% lending may be for sustenance. So these MSMEs do not turn into NPAs. But then because of these disruptions, COVID disruptions, they might have incurred certain losses which they may not be able to recover. Maybe some of their raw materials got spoiled. Maybe some of their money went bad. Some of the machineries need to be replaced. To support those type of activities and economic revival, that is also again a lending, I guess, a risky proposition. If the government comes out with a guarantee, I'm not expecting RBI, because RBI is not into the business of giving guarantee. It's the government with whom we have requested it. So if the government comes out with a guarantee scheme, and government has already come out with such schemes in the past, like CGTMSE and all that, So that scheme can facilitate the lender. Even if they take out a 10,000 crore rupees for this guarantee fund, bankers can multiply it and lend up to 1 lakh crore into the market, expecting that the NPA will be in the range of 10% and not more. So what I mean to say is, now the entire support from the entire ecosystem will be needed to propel the growth. It's not only the bankers are sitting, are not interested in lending, they would definitely like to lend on a higher rate of interest.
Right. That's an interesting point that you've made over here. But talking about the stressed assets, I know it will be very premature to ask you in terms of what's happening with the bad bank, you know, because the idea of a bad bank has made a comeback. Now, I know you'll be working pretty closely right now with the RBI as well with and with the government as to what's going to be the structure, what's going to be the ownership. But what is your assessment of the situation in terms of the bad bank? Do you think it will work this time?
The situation is most opportune for a formation of a bad bank, but bad bank is a basically we call it as a bad bank, but I think
it'll be a good bank.
It's a good bank. It's a really a good bank for the entire ecosystem. Why I'm saying so? Because there are four or five major factors which are running into the problem. One basic factor is for a large corporate, suppose there are it's a consortium advance, a big ticket advance, there are 10, 20, 30 lenders which form a consortium and lend to a single entity. So when you go for a resolution, the resolution for 30 entities to take a same decision simultaneously is impossible. So sometimes the time lag between the first decision and the last decision is as long as 1 year. In the meantime, the resolution process, all the assumptions of resolutions become haywire because within 1 year, the prospective buyer who is going to buy that unit may back out because of their own problems. Sometimes the international market may also change, so the resolution applicant may not be interested in acquiring that asset. Even the existing promoter may not be in a position to sustain it for that long period, and ultimately it will go into the bankruptcy. Even because of this pandemic, relaxations are expected from the bankruptcy code also. Bankruptcy code relaxation means the processes for realization through bankruptcy code also will get delayed. Because the cases may not be admitted during this pandemic period. There also the people will get moratorium and then things will get. So this is the ideal time where there's such type of assets can be aggregated. So and who can aggregate it? There has to be some entity which is backed by government so that people have a trust on it. It has got a larger transparency into it. So if the government creates and helps forward to this idea, with a, you call it a bad bank, I call it as an ARC. So suppose an ARC say comes out and which is backed by the government, and that ARC takes the pool of these assets at the predetermined values, and then the advantage is the collective decisions can be made by a single asset management company. So you don't have to involve 20 bankers to take a decision. The decisions can happen faster. They can scout for the better investors. They can manage that entity for the time being. Suppose you do not take any decision and you don't get a resolution applicant, in normal course it will go for liquidation. Absolutely. Liquidation you may realize value up to 10%, 20%, that's all. But if you don't go for a resolution, you are able to sustain it for a year and then you sell it when the market is right, you may realize up to 60%. So that 40% upside is available in the asset if you simply provide them this space for ARCs and AMC concept during the intervening period. Right. And right now, because the asset recognition started long back, I think cleaning up exercises started in 2016 itself. So all these assets, the adequate provisions are already available in them. So resolution will become much easier because bankers will be too willing to absorb that because they already have provided for them.
Right. So what's
is
the
a very right and opportunity?
Right. So what's the size of the bad bank that we are looking at?
Size of the bad bank is still under debate. It depends upon the how much equity the government is going to offer for it. And anyway, it can be in the range of 50,000 to 1 lakh, maybe any amount.
Right. So that's something we should be, I mean, some decisions on this, if announced today as well, will be a great news to hear on as well. But Sunil, overall,
we are not expecting today because we have sent this proposal just 3 days back.
3 days back. So,
if the government does it so fast, then we'll definitely appreciate. But we don't expect a response so quick. But I think they are going to come out announcing various measures in a phased manner. We are optimistic about it.
Right. I think everyone's optimistic about things like these, but let's hope for the best. Overall, with regards to the industry-wide average, what is it that is number that you could give us for the moratorium that has been availed? And out of this, what is the percentage for the unsecured retail loans where moratorium has been availed?
Actually, we don't have this data right now because IBA do not collect this data.
Okay.
And maybe once we get it, I'll share it with you.
Okay. And overall, any expectation that you are looking at on the slippages side, any numbers?
Slippages side, I don't think this slippages will spike because of the simple reason. There is no scope for slippages right now because moratorium is available.
Okay.
So slippages number are not going to spike. I'm not worried about slippages right now for the industry. That is being taken care of by the regulator. And if they find the situation is getting worse, they may even permit us for restructuring, which is also demanded by us. So if the, both these tools are available with the lenders, they have already provided two, three tools. One is moratorium. There is reassessment of the working capital by reassessing their credit needs. And the third, if the restructuring also come, I think then they, all these slippage woes can be taken care of the banking sector. So slippage is not is a big challenge for the industry right now.
That, so that's something which will be positive as well. And you know, we've spoken about the MSME segment, and that's something where everyone's expecting the maximum impact. So when we talk about the restructuring as well, if that's something that the government looks at, do you think restructuring of SME loans also could be a scheme that could be in the pipeline?
No, I think restructuring is already available. Because okay. RBI circular has already made it available earlier up to 31st March. Now the window has been extended up to 31st of December. So restructuring for MSME, that window is already available. What we are looking for is incremental lending.
Okay.
Guarantee for incremental lending. So these accounts, as MSMEs, which fall into any problem, their bankers can restructure them also. And to take care of their revival, they can refund them also, which can be backed by this guarantee. The combination of restructuring and lending for a revival, these two will work. Because restructuring will simply give you time, but it doesn't give you incremental fund.
Correct, correct.
So restructuring option is already available as per regulator. Only thing is, if the guarantee scheme comes, then additional lending options will also be available for this.
Right, so additional lending options is something that we need to watch out for. And, you know, a lot of companies that we've been talking to, Sunil, have been, you know, highlighting how the rural economy is not much impacted. And that's the fact as well, because if you see COVID impact, the number of infected patients is mainly in the cities. Rural is still far away, which is a positive. What does this actually hold for the banking industry if you have to look at it from the asset quality front, from the loan growth perspective?
Two things is, one thing is very simple. For agriculture sector, and why the pandemic impact is less in rural area, because it has direct correlation with the density of population. So which are the cities which are maximum impacted? It is cities like Bombay, than Delhi, because they have got the highest density of population. So impact of any contagious disease will be more where the density of population is more. So that's why the impact is more pronounced in metropolitan. It is less in rural areas. And especially since they do not travel much, that much of the people don't come from abroad, much of the people don't go to the areas which are infected. So they get isolated. So all whole life they suffer into the rural area. Now they are privileged one because they are getting that isolation as by their lifestyle itself. That is one advantage. Now, as regards, they are not getting impacted because a rural area is basically producing food items. And there is a, this is an inelastic demand. Pandemic or no pandemic, you will consume almost the same food. The demand, the vegetables, that will consume. So there is no impact on demand of this second because that is a constant, that is an inelastic demand. So that way it won't be impacted. Now, but saying that agriculture sector will not be impacted at all is not correct. For the simple reason, because for the agriculture sector, the prices is also dependent upon the demand and supply. So demand quantitative wise will not go up, but the economic level of the people also lead them to spend more on their food. So if the economy of the country as a whole do not flourish or it goes down, it will impact the prices of the agricultural commodities in the market. And that way, they will not be impacted by the quantities, but they might get impacted by the amount that for this numbers of the economies.
Right. And Sunil, lastly, in terms of sectors that need help right now in terms of working capital, I think no one is spared. Now, if you talk about the retail sector, that's something which is, again, organized, unorganized. They are the ones who, again, need the money. Hospitality is another space which, for revival, is going to need the funds. So, and if you talk about real estate, now, are these sectors going to be on the banker's radar to, you know, lend to, or do you think they will still be on the avoid category?
Two, three things. Bankers for lending will definitely require a viable proposition where they think the returns will come. So that is a basic principle, because bankers are in the business of lending and they have got certain predetermined risk management system. So whenever they will lend to a particular industry or a segment, they will look at the viability and the profitability of it for its repayment of that loan. As regards the real estate sector as well as for the hospitality sector, we have already given our recommendation to the government that yes, these are the sectors which are getting impacted the most. And we expect that government may come out with certain relief measures in that. Now, one of these type of sectors may require relief measures in two ways. One is a regulatory relief, another is economic relief. Regulatory relief, RBI has announced one or two already. They have provided one dispensation. Earlier, the real estate sector was not allowed to any shift in the date of completion of the project. But now, 1 year window has been provided to them. So, if the production, if the particular project get delayed by 1 year, they have got a scope of it. Getting their COD shifted by 1 year, and that will not be downgraded to NPA. So one relief has already been provided by the regulator. Now the second relief which may come and which we have sought for is restructuring across the board for all the sectors. So if restructuring window is also provided, then existing real estate which is almost ready, is looking for the buyers, they can get some respite because of the restructuring. They can hold the inventory for a little longer period and they need not sell it in the distress. Maybe economy, everything will have a, there has to be a solution for everything. Even this pandemic will also find a solution, maybe 3 months or 6 months or 9 months, that's the only difference.
Right.
So the moment some vaccine comes, the moment some proper treatment comes, the solution comes, the economy is going to bounce back. So if we just provide them with the breathing window for a period of 1 year, I think the demand can come back, the prices may come back, and they may be able to sustain, and that can be helped by the restructuring. So these are the two types of support. One has already been provided by RBI. Second, we are looking for, if that is provided, that will help the industry. And the third relief is economic relief. Economic relief can be found in various formulas. There can be certain subsidies, there can be interest subvention, and there can be tax concessions also. And any of the three ways the government can factor into it. So let us hope the government, PM has already announced the 20 lakhs crore of a package for the entire sector. We are very optimistic about it, and something will start today itself at 4 p.m. Let's wait and watch that everybody gets some relief in this announcements.
Yes, absolutely. I think everyone's waiting for relief as well. But my last question is, you know, you did mention about the 20 trillion stimulus package, but this already includes, you know, the measures that have been taken by the RBI as well as the government, right? So in totality, if you go to see the overall support that stands outstanding right now would be around, say, 9.7 to around 10 trillion rupees, or probably around 4.8 to 5%. Of the GDP, do you think that much will be enough?
It's not the quantity. Sometimes quantities can be less, but the impact can be more. The way I rightly said to you, you take out 1 lakh crore, it may not give benefit. You take out 15,000 crore for a guarantee, this can give you a benefit of maybe 1.5 lakh crore.
Correct.
For the simple reason, that is a multiplier effect.
Absolutely.
It's not only the quantum, it's the way you engineer it.
Yeah, the quality in what form it comes also is going to be important.
The quality, the way it is provided. Suppose a guarantee fund is created by corpus of 15,000 crore, it can lead an incremental lending to 1.5 lakh crore by the banks because they feel secure.
Correct.
A delicacy of 10%, the risk is taken away from their minds and they can aggressively lend to it. It's not only the quantum, it's the way it is designed will also have a greater impact on the economy.
Right. Absolutely, Sunil. In fact, thank you for joining us on the show. In fact, we will be awaiting a lot of announcements that come in at 4 p.m. Once respected Honorable Finance Minister will be speaking as well. But thank you for joining us. We will come back to you as well once something gets approved, especially with regards to a bad bank, which in turn is really going to be a good bank for the country. So we will await more updates from your side. Thank you for joining in and stay safe.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you.